Thank you. We all know about how challenging it is to compile JavaScript, how dynamic it is. It can change everything. It can create new types in runtime, can change inheritance chains. So for static compiler, it's almost impossible or ineffective to compile such a code. There are also eval, there is garbage collection, so it's a challenge to make it compile effectively and have a good performance. A simple solution would be to interpret JavaScript, and initially there were only interpreters, but then JIT compilers started to emerge. At first they were straightforward JIT compilers, and they were not really much more effective than interpreters. The other problems with the JavaScript are that you cannot do very complex optimizations in real time, because the user expects immediate response. When he clicks a button, the code should fire. But to make complicated optimizations, you need a time. So latency hurts. So the multi-tier multi-tier JIT is the answer, so you can trade off the responsiveness and more complicated optimizations that take time for good throughput. Also, doing that in parallel helps, because you can start interpreting the code and then in background doing compilation, run optimization passes, and when it's compiled, you can switch to a new effective native code. Most of the existing engines implement speculative compilation. So you do a profiling of the code. You can see what usually the values of variables are, and you can deduce that some variable has only integer values. So you can speculate it as integer, put into registers, and compile it almost like a C code. So you just insert checks that your assumption holds, and compile it more or less statically for this code, and switching it in a smart way from interpreter to basic JIT, and then to more advanced JIT. We worked with two most popular JavaScript engines. It's JavaScript Core in Apple's WebKit and V8 in Google's Blink. Mozilla and Microsoft engines stand aside, but they also have hierarchic JIT structure. The common features of modern JavaScript engines are that they all have multi-tier JITs. I will speak about the first two because I know it internally. They use on-stack replacement. They rely on profiling, on speculative execution. And the code, when after warm-up, is just about two times slower than C code. It's semantically like C, so it's not bad at all. Here I'd like to give credit to Andy, to his weblog, because it's a great source of information for V8 internals. So thank you, Andy. This is the scheme for JavaScript Core. First, it starts with interpreter. It gathers profile information mostly about types. And then after only a few iterations of a loop, it switches to a baseline JIT. It's a simple, very straightforward JIT. Then after another few hundred iterations, in parallel, it compiles to a speculative JIT. Now it has profile information. The code can be converted almost to static. And it does some more advanced optimizations. The next level added about 2-3 years ago is LLVM JIT. Later, they replaced it with their own compiler that essentially is simplified LLVM. They just re-implemented the optimizations they needed. It has a shrinked internal representation to save space in memory. But initially, it was LLVM. It's about 15% better speeds than on level 3 for Octane benchmark. This switch JIT levels with on-stake replacement, because on every JIT, values can be represented and physically located either on stack, on a register as the integer. So if the assumption about it being an integer fails, for example, because of integer overflow, we have to switch to interpretation and put it back to location where the interpreter it expects it to be. So we replace it on the optimization and put it back. Just for information, how much the JIT tiers differ in performance. This is from the author of FTL JIT. For browser mark, they're a little bit different, but still. Here we can refer LLVM as the same code in C. It has the same sense. Okay, this is the hierarchy for V8 before they added ignition and turbofan. So they have two levels. The first is basic JIT. The second is optimized and speculative JIT. It has two internal representation. Hydrogen is almost like SSA. And lithium is for register allocation. They also collect profile info and switch using on-stack replacement technique between native codes. What we are doing, we are adding just another JIT tier that uses LLVM. We are lowering SSA-like hydrogen IR to LLVM IR and then do JIT compilation. We are not the first with such a brilliant idea. There are many, many projects that do that. And I will talk, do a lightning talk about adding LLVM JIT to Postgres later. So that's what we do. V8 has interesting internal representation for its object. If the value is even, then it's a pointer to a boxed object. Floats are boxed. If it's odd, then we clear one bit. If they're even, they're just integers. So we can apply arithmetics. If it's even, then we clear one bit and it's a pointer. all of this done to use native arithmetics using CPU instructions. This is how crankshaft's internal representation looks. And we do lowering with our methods into LVM IR and then into native code. That's how it will look in crankshaft. So first we have to check whether the numbers we are adding up are integers. If not, we go to optimization. Those calls are actually not calls. Those never return. They call the optimizer, which goes back to basic full code engine. Then we add them up, and we have a double tap value of this sum in a register. So to optimize such a code, it's very complicated to optimize such control flow. What problems we had to solve to implement JavaScript JIT with LLVM? First is OSR entry, because on-stack replacement can happen when switching not at the start of the function, but in the middle of loop iteration. So we had to add an extra block, entry block to a loop, which adjusts stack. The next big thing is the optimization. In full code engine, it's a stack machine. So abstract syntax tree is first converted to stack machine code, and then it's JITed. So when we want to switch back to full code again, we need to trace where the values in stack are. And when emitting code at speculative JIT, there are special nodes that do simulation for this stack machine. So V8 itself at the second level JIT traces which value that it holds in CPU register, where it goes to stack location. And in case of the optimization, it maps it back using translation structure. So luckily, the people who were doing JITs before us in JavaVM, in FTL, in WebKit, they already put some infrastructure to trace LLVM values into stack or stack slot or register. So we create stack maps and then build a translation that can be used by V8 the optimizer. Another problem is garbage collection. Garbage collector can relocate not only objects, but JITed code. So if we have a function call from our code, it suddenly can move. So all the calls should be patchable. LLVM also has infrastructure for this. So we emit not simply calls, but patch points. And then we fill out the table, V8 internal tables, so it can do proper patching in garbage collection. Another thing which we had to change is ABI, because it makes use of, for example, R13 internally to hold a pointer to its root objects. It has special call stack format, so garbage collection can access closures in the functions. It walks the call stack and find objects by the pointers that are in the stack. And also the custom calling conventions, which we had to add to LLVM. So this is code from SunSpider. SunSpider is mostly, I guess for one half, is a rewritten C code into JavaScript. So we achieve a good speed up. This timing class includes time spent in LLVM compilation. So the more iterations we give, the more is the advantage. The advantage comes from loop unrolling. At the left is crankshaft code. At the right, LLVM managed to loop unroll it. It's just 256 shifted, so it's 8 iterations. We didn't have much time to optimize it, but here are the few ideas what can be done with LLVM to make better code. First, we looked at the loops and saw that most loop optimization doesn't work because of integer overflow checks. If there are no overflow checks, we can get SSE instruction work, but not AVX registers. Also, the hardware overflow check is the problem because LLVM can't deduce that it doesn't overflow. In this example, if in JavaScript we put a mask, V8 knows that there is no overflow and doesn't generate the intrinsic, so we can optimize it. And all that loop is shrinked into the final constant. If V8 doesn't do that, LLVM can't deduce it itself. In FTL, they do profiling, branch profiling. We don't support that at the moment, but it can be done. So at the moment, we finished the basic functionality, like support for garbage collection and de-optimization. And there are more things to investigate, for example, ASM.js code, because it shouldn't have that much integer overflows, how SMI checks can be eliminated, how object accesses can be optimized, and other things. Here are some SunSpider results. We support now 10 of SunSpider tests. In general, it's speed up for them. When we convert them to long spider, add the iterations, so to warm up and to eliminate startup time influence, there is more. Compatibility is pretty good now because most popular hydrogen nodes are implemented. And ASM.js code is almost as good as crankshafts, but the compile times ruins everything. So we have to pick optimizations carefully and look into ASM.js code to see what can be done to optimize it. So in the future, we'd like to do many performance tuning from both sides, from code generation, so LLVM can optimize it better, and to add optimizations to LLVM, so our code can be better optimized. Add SMGS specific optimizations. After the work is completed, we should be not worse than FTL JIT and WebKit with like 15% in Octane. There is also GitHub repository. There are several issues to be fixed, and we invite everyone to participate in this project and help us. So most basic functionality is implemented. The missing nodes can be lowered, and there is much performance tuning to be done. Thank you very much.